Welcome to this last session of the day. This session's titled Gender, Authority, and Identity. I'm Galen Henderson. I'm an associate professor in the Department of English and Literature here at UVU. I recently taught a class called Fearless Speech, Feminism, and Religion, where we talked about some of our presenters today and their work. So I'm excited to hear them and have them visit UVU. So I'll introduce our four speakers, and then we will have them go in that order. We'll hold our questions and comments until the end. Then we'll have them come up, and you can address them with your responses. So first we'll have Ryan Cragun. He's an associate professor of sociology at the University of Tampa. He received his MA and PhD from the University of Cincinnati, and his research interests include Mormonism and the non-religious. He is the author of more than 15 publications in a variety of journals, including the Journal for the Scientific Study of Religion, the Journal of Religion and Health, and the Journal of Contemporary Religion. He is involved in a variety of academic organizations, including the American Sociological Association, Mormon Social Science Association, the Non-Religion and Secularity Research Network, and the Center for Atheist Research. Ryan's talk today is titled, To Excommunicate or Not to Excommunicate, Evidence from the Mormon Gender Studies Survey. Our second speaker is Neylan McBaine. She's a graduate of Yale University and the founder of the Mormon Women Project, a nonprofit that publicizes interviews with LDS women around the world. Her writing has appeared in Newsweek, Dialogue, the Washington Post on Faith Religion blog, among others. Her book, Women at Church, has been hailed as, quote, a monumental piece of work and a remarkable resource that belongs in every Latter-day Saint home. Neylan is a brand strategist at Remark, an agency in Salt Lake City, and previously worked on the I'm a Mormon campaign. And her title is LDS Women and the Anatomy of Belonging. Our third speaker is Mette Ivie Harrison. She's the author of numerous books for children and for young adults, including The Princess and the Hound and Mirror, Mirror. Recently, she began writing adult mysteries, including The Bishop's Wife and His Right Hand. She holds a PhD in Germanic languages and literatures from Princeton and is a nationally ranked triathlete. A practicing Mormon, she is now a blogger for Huffington Post. Her talk is When Feminists Excommunicate. And finally, we'll hear from Maxine Hanks. She's a theologian who specializes in women's studies and religion with particular attention to Christian and Mormon contexts. Her book, Women in Authority, excavated Mormon feminist history, theology, and related discourse related to authority in ecclesiastical contexts. Subsequent books include Mormon Faith in America and Getting Together with Yesterday. She has served as a visiting fellow at Harvard Divinity School and as a research fellow with the Utah Humanities Council. Hanks has lectured at the University of Utah, Claremont Graduate University, the Mormon History Association, and the Sunstone Theological Symposium. And Maxine's talk today is Shifting Boundaries, What Have We Learned? Maybe we could have a round of applause for all of our presenters and welcome Ryan to the stage.
So I'm going to start out a little theoretical, just kind of thinking about this idea of boundary maintenance, how we might think about it as sociologists. I'm a sociologist. That one approach that we might take is to see deviance and social control as functional, right? That they actually serve a function. And I do this in my classes. It's just the way that I am. I like to use pictures and graphics a lot. So if we just kind of assume that this represents the church, right? So we've got the church here, and I try to get my missionaries, but we got the church, right? And of course, there are members in the church who maybe go online or maybe find information somewhere. But as they start to learn more about certain things, or maybe they engage in certain activities, they might start to butt up against the border, the boundary of the church, right? And when that happens, they may, of their own accord, decide to leave, or perhaps they cross a boundary, a border, and as a result, that border gets emphasized. So the border is, of course, the key, and this is all about boundary maintenance. So it could perhaps happen that then they get kicked out. And what this does, of course, is it emphasizes where the borders are. So one of the functions of deviance, if you will, is to reiterate where the borders are. Now, of course, where I'm going today is talking about disciplinary councils, but the manifest function of a court of love, that euphemistic term, or a disciplinary council, is to help the member, right? That the stated reason is we want to help this member because they did something wrong. But one of the things that we think about as sociologists is that not everything has just manifest functions. Many things have latent functions as well. So a latent function would be the unstated purpose, and one of the unstated purposes of sending somebody for a disciplinary council is to tell everybody else, here's the line you cannot cross. So we would argue that deviance is in fact functional. You can see where you can't go based on where the boundaries are and those who cross them. So obviously this ties into boundary maintenance. Boundary maintenance is just another way of describing the functions of deviance and social control. That's what's happening, and of course that's the topic of the conference. There are lots of informal means of enforcing social norms and doing this boundary maintenance. I have one kind of simplistic story here, which is actually not from recent times, but right after I returned from my mission, a former stake president, President Paul, and there are plenty of Pauls, so I'm not outing anybody, actually said this to me as I started to grow my hair long. He said, I'd never let my missionaries grow their hair long like that. You can tell how worthy someone is by the length of their hair. To which I quickly responded, Jesus had long hair, which he didn't like. But the idea, of course, is that he is reinforcing informally social norms, that males in the church are not supposed to have long hair. And this is a form of boundary maintenance, if you will, or informal social control. You can also do this, and it has a slightly different effect, by treating women differently, perhaps. Because this is, at the same time, a form of reiterating social control or boundary maintenance. So pulling some data from the survey that I'm about to talk about, this is the Mormon Gender Issues Survey, which I'll give more information on this in a minute. We did ask a bunch of questions, and this was targeted specifically towards women. Men were asked if they've observed this. Women were asked if they've experienced certain things in the last 3 months. And I just pulled two of these because I thought they were kind of interesting. So here is the response from our survey of women who said that they had been told that they should dress a particular way to help boys or men have pure thoughts. And it turns out about 24% said, yes, I have experienced that in the last 3 months, right? Lot lower, but this one right here, feeling left out of baby blessings, about 4% of Mormon women said, yes, I've experienced this. Again, these actions, so being forced into this situation is a form of boundary maintenance or informal social control, where they're basically being told, your position in the hierarchy is here, okay? So obviously, boundary maintenance can reinforce a lot of things. It can reinforce appropriate or inappropriate behavior, like hair length for men. It can also reinforce status in a social hierarchy. So who is on top in the hierarchy and who is on bottom? Women's position in the church would be relative to men, and by forcing them to not participate in baby blessings, or maybe that they're supposed to dress a certain way because that affects how men behave, again, it's setting their position relative to men. The ultimate form of boundary maintenance would be determining somebody's in-group or out-group status. Do you get to remain a member of the group, or are we going to push you out, right? And that would be the ultimate tool of boundary maintenance, because we're saying this is the line. You crossed it, you no longer get to be a part of the in-group, we're gonna push you out. So that's really where I'm headed today. I wanna look at that particular issue using some data that we gathered from the Mormon Gender Issues Survey. Obviously, this is tied into women's ordination. That was the primary focus of what we were doing. So the question that we really were asking was getting at this. What do members of the LDS Church, and that's who's in the survey, think about other members who want women to be ordained? Okay. So here's the actual question that we asked in the Mormon Gender Issues Survey, and I'm going to talk more about the data collection in just a second. Here's the question. Church leaders have indicated that each congregation is responsible for conducting its own disciplinary courts. If a member of your LDS ward were to publicly express his or her support for the ordination of women to the priesthood, what would your response be? Okay, so we're kind of getting at this question of, okay, somebody is saying, I support the ordination of women. These are the response options that we gave them, okay? And I'll go through these just quickly. So one was do nothing, just let it be. Another was actually to encourage him or her to express their views. Next one, encourage them to express their views, but remind them to refrain from trying to persuade others to accept them. This next one, acknowledge their private beliefs, but discourage them from publicly expressing them. And our last one, which again, this is getting right at the heart of do we excommunicate or not, was to refer the individual for formal disciplinary counsel. Lastly, we gave people the option of other. I will show just very briefly, a surprisingly large percentage of people chose other. It's about 10%. With the size of our survey, which was 60,000 plus people, that turns into a lot of responses. And they got to write in what why they had the other. I had a colleague go through and code those. Most of the other, just to catch that question early, most of these are actually one of these responses, but they wanted to explain themselves, right? So that's really all it is. So don't like, oh, the other, you know, it's a whole different category. It's really those, but they just wanted to add comments. So we got a lot of that. All right, so the survey itself, some of you may have heard of it, but this is kind of just a side piece of this. Data from this snowballer purposive sample that we did. We gathered data online, so we posted links to the survey on a number of different platforms, and very quickly got a sizable sample. By the end, we had over 90,000 people show up to take the survey. About 20,000 of those people didn't finish it, and after we cleaned the data and removed the people who had taken it multiple times because they wanted to know what we were trying to do, we got down to about 61,000 cases, right? Now, understand, I'm not saying that this is a representative survey. Yes, it's large, and that's great, but it's a snowball sample, and that comes with all the problems that you get with snowball samples, but this is the number that we ended up with. I'm going to take a subset of that because we had thousands of people from outside the United States. We had some other categories in here. I'm going to take a subsample that I'm going to analyze here. I'm focusing only on the individuals who indicated that they identify as LDS and are on church records, but I'm not excluding people from outside the U.S., right? Which in most of the other stuff that we've published based on this, we've excluded people outside of the U.S. I don't think we need to on this particular issue. So my N for this one is about 44,936, right? But this does limit it explicitly to just those who say, yes, I identify as LDS, and yes, I'm on the church records. That's who we're looking at here. Again, it's just a sample. It's not a nationally representative sample. It's just a very large sample. All right. So here are our initial responses, since I know you're all interested in this. There's the do nothing, right? It's about 24%. Encourage them. About 11%. This is keep them to themselves, but encourage them. It's about 28%. Here's the acknowledge. And this part I have to admit, I was a little surprised, was just 2.6% of all of the people we surveyed said I would refer them to a disciplinary council. Now, we're going to dig a little deeper because I think there's a lot here that we can play with, right? But when we look at this, and I did just kind of pull that out so we could see that particular number, what this suggests is that most Mormons are basically fine with people having private beliefs, right? That they don't immediately jump to the conclusion you should be disciplined for having those private beliefs. What I want to do now is just kind of, we call it bivariate analysis. Let's look at how this varies by a variety of other things. So we have a lot of demographic information on the people who took the survey. We're just going to kind of run those comparative to each other and see how this plays out. Some of these first ones, we're not going to see a whole lot of variation, but we see some things that are actually quite interesting. So what we have here is just the responses. These are the same responses, right? There's nothing different here. They're in the same order, right? But this one's by age. So if you take our age brackets, this is 18 to 30, 31 to 50, and 51 plus, you see a little bit of variation, but there's actually not a whole lot of variation here in terms of their overall responses to that same question of what should be done if you have a member of your ward who supports the ordination of women. Age didn't seem to be a big factor, right? Here's by race. The only one that really kind of pops out, which I thought was interesting, 6.8% of our Black or non-Hispanic respondents actually said they would refer them to a disciplinary council. It's about three times the average of everybody else. But otherwise, again, there's not huge differences by race. Okay? So race didn't seem to matter for this. But we start to see a little bit of a pattern with educational attainment. So if you pay attention to this, right, we're basically going from lower educational attainment to higher educational attainment at this end. And there's a pretty clear pattern running across the data that if you look at it, right, we have more and more people. So here's our do nothing, but larger segments here saying I would encourage them, that I like the idea of women being ordained, right? And we actually see smaller percentages as we go across for this particular one, and actually for these as well. So we see a specific trend by educational attainment. We see something similar by income. So income, again, we're going from poor, right, up to our more wealthy, and we see a very similar, and I'm not running trend lines, right? I'm just pointing out these trends. We could actually talk about trend lines if you wanted, but just kind of pointing out that there does appear to be a little bit of a trend. So it's there, we're seeing it, but then we start to hit somewhere it's a little bit bigger. There's political orientation. And this is one where you really see a massive difference, right? Where it really stands out, and it's impossible not to see it on this one. So for our most conservative members of the church, 8.3% say, yeah, send them to a disciplinary council. Whereas for our most liberal, right, it's down here around 1%, and the percentage who are saying I would encourage them jumps up to 52%, which is pretty shocking, right? But we can see very clear variation by political orientation. So I'm just pointing that out. And again, very similar trend lines just showing this. Here's by activity level, not surprising, though perhaps surprising in light of some of our other findings. We could maybe come back to that. The most active members are actually kind of the least supportive of this, whereas our least active members are the most supportive of women saying, or somebody saying that they would want women to be ordained. Again, same pattern. This is temple recommend status. Not surprisingly, it's very similar to the last one. I want to get to another one here real quick. This is by the respondents' support for the ordination of women. So kind of our big finding is that we asked two different ways that you could capture whether they support the ordination of women. This is the Pew version, right, which is, do you think a worthy member of your religion should be allowed to be ordained to the priesthood? And those who said no, right, obviously we've got more down here on the do nothing, very little support here, basically acknowledging it but don't tell anybody, and then our disciplinary council. Here are those who said yes, right, which is only between 10 and 12% of the Mormon population that we have, but we see a full 72% actually say yes. I would encourage them to say this. All right, so what do we have? And I'm trying to keep this short. We've got plenty of other presentations. Really, it's only a small percentage of members who think that believing that a woman should be ordained is grounds for a disciplinary council. It's a relatively small percentage, right? The majority see no problem with individual members believing that women should be ordained as long as they keep it to themselves and don't try and persuade anybody else, which we can talk about what that means practically, right? But that's what the majority of members actually believe. While, of course, this is less definitive than excommunication, this really does suggest that there are still efforts at boundary maintenance, because you're pretty much telling people, you know, that's fine to believe it, but you can't tell anybody. Don't tell anybody that you believe it, right? And certainly don't try and persuade anybody. Obviously, we mentioned this, perspectives vary by educational attainment, political orientation, a variety of other things. And then finally, just kind of as a future question, what we didn't ask, right, which maybe in a future iteration of this survey, we could ask something like this. We don't know how Mormons would respond if we asked about acting on that belief, which I think is a next question, an obvious kind of follow-up to that. But we'll end there. So that's what we've got.
I'm going to be exploring today what it looks like to belong to the mainstream global sisterhood of Mormon women. And I'd like to start by sharing two stories. The first story came in the form of an email comment while I was a guest on a local radio show about a year and a half ago. A woman wrote into the show and she said this: "As a 44-year-old stay-at-home mom, I am sorely tempted to blame my LDS culture for significantly narrowing my life choices. As I write this, my youngest of five children entered first grade 2 months ago, and I'm home today using craft paint to fix the dings in my fall-themed pottery and planning my lavish Christmas decorations on Pinterest. I'm mad. How did I get here? I guess I have to own my own choices and stop playing victim. But I was strongly socialized to choose the path that I did. Yet, I have friends who managed to pursue professional courses that I now envy. One of my friends mentioned the powerful female role model she had at her home. I think my biggest regret is not being that role model now for my four daughters." The second story I draw from my personal experience being the daughter of a professional opera singer. My mom sang as a soloist at the Metropolitan Opera the whole time I was growing up and had an illustrious tenure at the San Francisco Opera before I was born. One time, I was trying to be a good family history student, and I asked her about her youth and how her career got started, and she told me a remarkable story. She told me about singing a solo recital at BYU soon after she had graduated from there and was teaching music at a local junior high. So this was about 1965. She was starting to audition as a soloist and getting quite a bit of attention at the time, and she would soon move to California to dedicate herself to a solo career. She was unmarried at this time. And after the recital at BYU, none other than Hugh Nibley came up to her to congratulate her on a job well done. "But Sister Bybee," said the towering campus hero, "how do you expect to be able to continue with this singing and be a wife and a mother? You know it will be impossible to do both, so you should give it up soon." Stunned, I looked at my mom. "Well, Mom, what did you say? I mean, this was Hugh Nibley." My mom just gave me a surprised glance and dismissively said, "Well, I ignored him, of course." Why, my mother in 1965, under the disapproving eye of the likes of Hugh Nibley and presumably others, was able to so confidently and clearly be so confident and clear in the path that was right for her is a mystery that I've sought to unpack my whole adult life. What is the difference between my mother and the woman from the radio show who, despite several decades of presumed social liberalization, found herself socialized into a path that was not authentically hers? Both my mother and the woman from the radio show define themselves as Mormon women. Speaking for my mother, at least, those are the first and most important descriptors of who she is, beloved descriptors, as they are for most of the 300-plus women we've interviewed for the Mormon Women Project. Those descriptors provide a binding force that holds together millions of women around the world, descriptors many of us love. They appeal to the essential human need to belong to a community, a tribe with whom we have things in common and from whom we expect mutual respect. Our community goes beyond just a social club, though, as President Linda Burton reminded us at this latest women's session of conference. We belong to a divine sisterhood, circumnavigated by a range of binding factors, from as little as shared knowledge of primary songs to the dedication demanded by temple covenants. So even though these two qualifiers, woman and Mormon, are potent definers of belonging for many of us, they are also remarkably broad in today's contemporary church. A new convert in Zimbabwe is just as much a Mormon woman as the mom of five in Draper, Utah. And so I am interested in what defines belonging to this worldwide sisterhood. What shape does belonging take today? What are its essential parts? How do those parts function together? And what parts are extraneous? What is the heart of belonging? And what is the appendix that can be removed without damaging the whole? In looking at the definition of Mormon womanhood, it seems to me that the boundaries of that community have shifted over the past almost 200 years, from initially being prescribed by the institution in the early days of the Nauvoo Relief Society, to essentially being defined today by the Mormon women themselves in today's modern global church. Let me explain what I mean. Let's start with a look at the Nauvoo Relief Society, established 174 years ago. The organization acted as a sub-community within boundaries of Mormon womanhood, one to which women applied for membership. The recent book publishing documents from the first 50 years of Relief Society revealed to me a previously unknown detail about membership in that inaugural Relief Society. New members needed to receive the endorsement of two peers testifying to their virtue and worthiness to be admitted into the organization. In other words, the boundaries of Mormon womanhood were drawn institutionally around a tight subset of women whose behavior was uncompromised. Learning about this recommendation process made me uncomfortable because it feels antagonistic to the concept of the welcoming Relief Society gatherings many of us experience today. It's as if the early Mormon women were saying, this is what belonging is, this is what it looks like. The standard of virtue and morality were the essential elements that gave the sisterhood its shape at that point. I can understand the institutional boundary drawing better when I put it in the context of temple preparation. The women were preparing the subset to receive and perform ordinances, so membership in the Relief Society was more then like receiving a temple recommend than entering the embrace of a community of fellow sinners. But the Nauvoo Relief Society provides the most stark example of Mormon womanhood being strictly defined by a set of behavioral markers. Although the recommendation process was not continued early 20th century Mormon womanhood had its own unofficial behavioral markers for establishing belonging in the sisterhood. For example, the behavioral practices around motherhood replaced those peer recommendations as ways to gauge a woman's tether to the sisterhood's gravitational pull. Even though Mormon womanhood had increased in numbers since the Nauvoo days, church membership was still homogeneous enough that institutional and cultural markers drew the boundaries around acceptable belonging. Mid-century American women stayed home with children, canned food, made quilts, creating for themselves, sometimes basing their actions on doctrinal principles, but mostly out of tacitly agreed upon cultural markers, what made a good Mormon woman. The consistency of those practices among a majority of women created a sense of belonging and drew a boundary between those who participated in those same behavioral markers and those who didn't. Similar to the Nauvoo Relief Society, women themselves seemed to be good police of who is within the boundaries and who is outside, even though the 20th century version of inclusion was less official than the 19th century's. So moving into the 21st century, who is determining the boundaries today? Who is defining what belonging to the mainstream sisterhood of Mormon women looks like? I propose that the growth of the church, the rapid pace of social, technological, and economic progress over the last several decades has produced a new era of boundary drawing, one in which belonging should be defined by fewer and fewer universal behavioral practices across the group, and instead, belonging should simply be claimed by the members of the group themselves when they enter that most universal of covenants, baptism. The new convert from Zimbabwe belongs to the sisterhood of Mormon women because she is a woman and because she has made baptismal covenants. Those may be the only common denominator she has with the mom of five and Draper, but the sense of belonging comes from their willingness to embrace and be embraced, not exclusively from their participation in practices institutionally deemed appropriate for female members of the church. But perhaps this modern vision of belonging as simply a willingness to embrace and be embraced is a little too idealistic at this point. I am the first to admit that that transition isn't quite complete, where sisterhood is a choice we nurture to make the diversity of our membership thrive. Perhaps there are some of us who still feel like we need to participate in social or behavioral markers in order to be in the fold. We need to be married. We need to have multiple children. We need not to have too successful of a career. We need to dress demurely. We need to have our lives together and functional. In reality, even though we are theoretically widening our embrace to expand the boundaries of belonging in the 21st century, many of us do still feel a bright line between being in and out. So let me restate my thesis about the mainstream Mormon woman's choice to belong. In my observation, I have seen a pattern in that women who have healthy, happy relationships with the Relief Society and the church institution as a whole are those who have set firm boundaries for themselves around what it means to be a Mormon woman. They have acknowledged that they will disappoint someone, they will make waves, they will not live up to a behavioral ideal, and they're okay with that. They have internalized the idea that the baptismal covenants keep them tethered to other women, and they have limited their commitments to socialized expectations beyond that. They belong on their own terms and enjoy the fruits of belonging while acknowledging the tribalism that is often a byproduct of belonging has its limits for them. They have done this while also respecting that the church needs to set boundaries in order to function as well, and some of those boundaries will not encircle them. Referring to the story of my mom from the beginning of my comments, my mom, whether she knew it or not, had set boundaries for how Mormon womanhood would define her. And I can testify that she took the best parts of our global sisterhood and then acted with integrity on her own choice to belong. She was not married in the temple, only had one child, and was a full-time professional, and yet acted every day like she was the most belonging belonger there was. In this observed pattern, those who have less happy and healthy relationships with Mormon womanhood have been less boundaried about what they will and will not embrace from the institution. From my anecdotal experience, many friends who have left the church believed while active that most of what and almost everything the church leaders taught needed to be accepted and internalized by themselves. Belonging necessitated allowing the church institution to push them in ways that felt uncomfortable or wrong, resulting in a complete break with the church when belonging devoured all ability to be individual agents. In the language of my friend from the radio program, belonging looked like crafting and decorating from Pinterest because those are the behavioral indicators she understood to mark belonging, but they left her resentful and mad. She had absorbed a definition of herself that was perhaps unexamined, lacking in boundary, and thus the choice to belong hadn't been a choice at all, but rather a default. So why is it that some Mormon women are naturally more boundaried than others? What is it that allows some to say, I choose to belong on my own terms, sometimes in the face of severe cultural pressures? Dr. Susan Madsen, a professor of leadership and ethics here at UVU, recently wrote in the journal Leadership Education about four perspectives that inform a Mormon woman's perception of herself, and I think these four perspectives are useful in this discussion. The perspectives are, one, an eternal perspective, meaning a dedication to lifelong learning and progression, continuous improvement and development. The second is a motherhood perspective, meaning a belief that raising children in love and righteousness is the most important role a woman has on earth. Third, a community perspective, meaning a belief that serving and helping others is central to one's life purpose. And four, a personal revelation perspective, meaning finding answers for oneself through direct communication with God. I think we sometimes have a tendency to assume that baptismal covenants result in a group alignment of these perspectives, where we share the weight and prioritization of each perspective uniformly. We overlook the fact that spiritual personalities come in as many forms as earthly personalities, and some perspectives more naturally and easily come to others than some than others. We do this especially with women. If we were to map my mother along these four different spiritual perspectives, a la the Myers-Briggs personality test or some other test, I think that we would see the personal revelation and community perspectives would jump off the charts for her, whereas perhaps the motherhood perspective would be less emphasized in her spiritual personality. Although my mom wanted to have more children and couldn't, her right to belong wasn't jeopardized because she felt confident in her ability to contribute other equally important perspectives. She somehow instinctively realized she couldn't be all things to all people, and her contributions to the group were still sufficient to be a full-fledged belonger on her own terms. Like any successful work team where personality tests are so often used to enrich group dynamics, our global sisterhood thrives off of the varied spiritual strengths, perspectives, and contributions of our membership. Unfortunately, we don't act or think along these lines as often as we should. If we were to similarly profile my radio friend, her spiritual personality might not actually have looked very different from my mom's in theory, but in practice, the motherhood perspective had trumped all and seems to have given her a lopsided profile that wasn't in line with her authentic self. She let herself be too extensively defined by her Mormon womanhood rather than defining Mormon womanhood for herself. We Mormons are not good at establishing or respecting personal boundaries, of saying, this is what I can give my membership and this is what my membership gives me. We are afraid we will disappoint others. We conflate perfection with cultural markers. Boundaries are not easy. But I believe that as we have more conversations about how to make inspired and loving boundaries with both church members and the institution, our sense of belonging will actually blossom rather than wither. We will be able to acknowledge the various spiritual personalities, those with eternal perspectives, community perspectives, motherhood perspectives, and confidently accept that our spiritual personalities will result in varied offerings to the group. What one person brings to the table is something another cannot. What is comfortable for one person to accept blindly is not comfortable for another. The famed research professor Brené Brown talks extensively about the relationship between boundaries and compassion, stating that the most compassionate people she has ever interviewed are also the most boundaried. And what does compassion have to do with belonging? Well, in this present and future age I'm describing, when belonging to Mormon womanhood is a choice to embrace and be embraced by others with whom we may have little else in common, compassion for each other is the very glue that will keep our global sisterhood tethered together. We are no longer tethered to each other by universal, traditional, Americanized wifehood and motherhood. We are no longer tethered by what our kitchens look like or what we do at homemaking activities. Compassion for each other will be the defining characteristic of belonging, and that compassion flourishes when we have a personal understanding of what we bring to the table, what we don't bring to the table, what it's okay for other people to do to us, and what it's not okay. Brené Brown uses the BIG acronym to describe the relationship between boundaries and compassion. She asks herself, what boundaries need to be in place for me to stay in my integrity and make the most generous assumptions about the people I interact with? Generosity, she claims, can't exist without boundaries. And in our modern global church, belonging can't exist without generosity. I'm not as sweet as I used to be, says Brown of the changes she made after establishing boundaries for herself. But I'm far more loving. Imagine the sisterhood that could exist if we honestly defined our boundaries, what spiritual perspectives we excel at, and which others we simply do not. What part of the institution's cultural practices enrich our lives and which do not? What if we were at peace with those boundaries and generously acknowledged that others are living within their own boundaries? The heart of our belonging is our covenant keeping, the compassion that comes from embracing and being embraced. I don't think I've ever quoted Dr. Seuss publicly before, but I'm going to hear today. In his brilliant story, The Sneetches, Dr. Seuss explores the human tendency to look for external markers of belonging. The story tells about two groups of sneetches who live on a beach. One group has stars on their bellies and the others don't. The ones with stars on their bellies think they are better than the plain belly sort and actively keep out those sneetches without stars from their group. There is a clear boundary dividing those who are in from those who are out, although they are all sneetches. A character, whose last name makes my children chuckle, Sylvester McMonkey McBaine, arrives with a fantastical machine that will give stars to those sneetches who have none, which is thrilling to the plain bellies until those who had stars at the start realize that it's no longer special to have a star, and that now not having a star is the marker of belonging. Chaos ensues as each group of sneetches pay to race through the machine, having stars put on or taken off depending on what the other group is doing. Seuss writes in one of my favorite lines that the sneetches ran through the machine until neither the plain nor the star bellies knew whether this one was that one was this one, or which one was what one, or what one was who. McBaine leaves convinced that no, you can't teach a sneetch. But happily, the story ends with the exhausted and penniless sneetches unifying on the beach, realizing that there is no in and out, but simply a shared identity to appreciate. Today, the Lord asks us to create unity without stars, without the behavioral or social or cultural markers we relied on in the past to establish belonging. It's a grand experiment, a latter-day challenge to maintain that cohesive global community without as many measurable standards. The sneetches learn to do it after much struggle. Are we yet in a place where we can say, I don't have a star, that's okay. She doesn't have a star, that's okay. Can we rely on compassion and covenant keeping as the only needed tether? And by the way, it's never too late to craft a more personal definition of Mormon womanhood. My friend from the radio went and enrolled in law school. Thank you.
Then I'll tell you the jokes. I have jokes at the beginning. So the first joke is, why do people invite writers to these sorts of things? It's a perpetual item of perplexment for me. You do know that my ideal is to spend all of every day sitting on a couch typing words into a computer. My children leave in the morning for school and I'm sitting on the couch, and they come home from school and I'm still sitting on the couch. And they think that being a writer is the most boring job in the world, which perhaps it would be to people who are not extreme introverts. I wrote an essay for Jana Reese's blog just a few months ago on challenges for extreme introverts who are also Mormons and have to spend 3 hours at church on Sundays interacting with other humans. So just think about that. You should know that when people say that I'm a nationally ranked triathlete, that is true, but I also don't leave my house for that. I have a treadmill in my basement and I have my bike on a trainer so that I don't have to leave my house and interact with other humans while I'm training. More of my stories. When I was, how old was I? I was 20. I just turned 20 when my to-be husband got back from his mission. Thank you. And I was headed off to graduate school by the time he got back from his mission. I had finished my degrees at BYU early, and I was headed off to Princeton, and I said to him, after he'd been back from his mission, I don't know, maybe 4 or 5 weeks, I said, hey, look, you know, I think we have a great relationship and everything, but if you're not interested in moving it to the next level before I leave for Princeton, you should know I will consider our relationship ended and will be dating other people and considering them for marriage, which he perhaps interpreted as an ultimatum. Now, I didn't exactly propose to him, but my mother, who, she was 40 when I was born, so she was considerably older than I am, and in some ways is generationally the age of my grandmother. My mother was horrified and humiliated when she heard what I had done, and promptly went to Albertson's, the one in Provo, and where my husband worked. And she bought stuff there, and then my husband bagged it up for her, as was his job. And as he was walking her out to the car to take her groceries and put them in the trunk for her, she proceeded to tell him exactly what she thought of my ultimatum and told him that he should tell me to go jump in a lake. Thank you. Yes, I am very short. He did not tell me to go jump in a lake. He, in fact, followed me out to Princeton, went to a different school than he had intended so that I could finish my PhD. However, when I got pregnant when I was in graduate school, I still remember when I told my professors, I was nearly finished at the time, but I told my professors that I was pregnant, and one of them, you have to know the man to realize how shocked he was to have said this out loud. He said, "On purpose?" And I assured him, yes, on purpose. So I came back and worked at BYU for a couple of years as an adjunct. And I remember one of the professors there telling me, sitting me down and having a conversation with me about the importance of me getting a full-time job as a professor. He said, "No one gets a PhD to stay home with their kids." I stopped teaching at BYU in 1997. And it's been a good long time since I was in an academic community like this one. So, all right, now we'll go to the actual talk. Okay. If you're aware of social media, you may have seen a post last week going around about Kim Kardashian. Some feminists called out Kim Kardashian for posing nude and calling it feminist. No, the feminist insisted, it's not just feminist because you said it is. It's just recycling the old sexist stuff and pretending that because you're in charge and you're getting paid, it's okay now. Of course, it isn't. And a couple years before that, it was Miley Cyrus being taken down by Sinead O'Connor because she was allowing herself to be degraded by putting herself in a music video with a disgusting sexist man who was also making Miley a ton of money. Sinead promised Miley that she would regret this later in life and offered her advice from an older, wiser perspective to have more respect for herself and her body. These are only two examples of the feminist wars that are going on. And I remember participating in the war. I cheered Sinead O'Connor and reposted her letter to Miley. I was disgusted by Miley's actions and considered her a deluded teenager who was being used by the men around her. Only now, it maybe seems that that wasn't quite that simple of an equation. I'm not trying to glorify Miley here or excuse her. The particulars of this are not the point of my talk. My point is that there seems to be a particular brand of feminism, which is the right brand, and which feels self-righteous enough to go around pointing the finger at all the other kinds of feminists and telling them that they aren't right. Women having power isn't enough. They have to have the right kind of power. Women having money isn't enough. They have to get it the right way, the feminist way. All right, let's see how... Press the space bar. All right, so perhaps you remember the feminist backlash against Twilight and against its creator, the Mormon Stephanie Meyer, and how it was 100 times worse against the women who loved 50 Shades of Grey and against the creator of that work, which was originally a Twilight fanfic. These women, E.L. James and Stephanie Meyer, wrote about female characters who found power in the relationships with the men in their lives. They wrote primarily to female audiences. They made a ton of money, but they didn't do it the right way. They fell back on old stereotypes about men and women, and they are not the right kinds of feminists. This all reminds me very strongly of a former friend of mine who wrote an angry comment on a Huffington Post essay of mine saying that I wasn't a, quote, real Mormon anymore. Well, who decides who is a real Mormon? That's part of this conference. We actually do have people who decide who is a real Mormon. And if it isn't the same authority who presides in every disciplinary council to decide on excommunication, it's at least the same set of principles. Well, maybe.
Being a real feminist or not is fraught with many more complications. Who decides if you are a real feminist? Is there a council of proper feminists? Is there an appeal process if you've been mistakenly thrown out of feminism? Not as far as I know. And yet, I am as guilty of pointing the finger at other women and saying they aren't feminists as anyone else. I am still processing the reaction to a couple of my feminist essays at Huffington, one called, "If We Don't Feel Oppressed, Are We?" To which my answer was, yes. And another, "What It's Like to Be a Mormon Woman." The first one I wrote in an attempt to speak to Mormon women who complain that they don't feel oppressed, and so the fault must be in the women who do feel oppressed, or not in the system itself, but in the men the other women are assigned to locally. I'm afraid what I did instead was make women feel as if they weren't real women, or that their way of finding power and wielding it wasn't real. In the second essay, I meant to describe what it would be like for a non-Mormon to slip into the body of a Mormon woman and what differences would be surprising in inhabiting a Mormon woman's body. I'm afraid that it came off as contemnatory and even mocking, as if I was saying that the habits of being a Mormon woman are ridiculous and outdated and that our modesty habits in particular are silly. I realized after reading some very angry reactions from traditional Mormon women that I had made them feel very much the way that I felt when I castigated women choosing to stay at home because it made their husbands statistically more likely to treat women badly in the workplace. Was it my fault that this was true of other men? My choice was an individual one, and my husband is also an individual. Our marriage isn't a stereotype. It's what we have found works for us and our family. If there are certain aspects of it that seem like we are falling back on a sexist default, it's still what works for us and our family. So I feel like it's hard enough figuring out what things work for you without being told that you are making a bad feminist choice or that you are simply a bad feminist. So here we go. When feminists tell other women they are oppressed or deluded, are we oppressing them all over again? Are we placing ourselves and our feminism above other people's feminism? And are we really repeating the patriarchal way of valorizing one male kind of living and of getting power? All right, a question for you. Who is a real feminist? Is Jane Austen a real feminist? Jane Austen wrote about drawing rooms and the women who inhabited them. She wrote about women who lived very isolated lives. She wrote about women who lived in the upper class, women who often never left their home villages. What about Harriet Beecher Stowe, who wrote the book that possibly caused the Civil War and led to the Emancipation Proclamation? Is Emma Watson a true feminist? Is Beyoncé a true feminist? Everybody knows Ruth Bader Ginsburg and Gloria Steinem are true feminists, but how about Kate Kelly? Does she count? Does Chieko Okazaki count? Does Neylan McBaine count? How about Marjorie Hinckley or Bonnie Oscarson? Where do we draw the line? When I was in graduate school writing a dissertation on a forgotten woman author of 18th century Germany, I was told on multiple occasions that I wasn't feminist enough. Why? Number one, I had changed my name when I married. My decision was made after months of careful consideration. I could see no real way in which I could take my mother's name. Her last name was, after all, her father's, and so on forever. I could only choose between keeping my father's name, someone with whom I'd had a very strained relationship, and taking my husband, who had helped empower me in many ways. I chose to take my husband's name and considered it a feminist choice. Number two, I got pregnant when I was in grad school. Yes, on purpose. and yes, I did plan to alter my career aspirations because of having children. Number three, I was writing about a woman writer who had 10 children, who supported them with her writing, and her writing was all about empowering girls, but in traditional feminine ways. There was nothing really groundbreaking about her writing. Number four, I knit, crochet, quilt, and cook, and I find satisfaction in these traditionally feminine activities. I also knitted in class fairly often. My male professors did not like it. My female professors were a little more understanding, and often came and asked me what I was doing and if I would knit something for them. Number five, I was a Mormon, and everyone knows if you're a Mormon, you can't actually be a feminist. One of my professors, whose name I will tell you if you ask me later, told me that the greatest cause of oppression of women was religion, and it was the first thing one had to give up if one wanted to be a feminist. And number six, I read and wrote romance novels, which are, of course, the most repetitive, unliterary, and repressive of all genres. So for a long time, I felt like I had been excommunicated from feminism. While I was busily writing young adult novels about strong female characters to the ever-growing audience of young adult and adult female readers, I raised three daughters to question stereotypes of femininity outside and inside of Mormonism. And I tried to find another word for my ideas about gender. About a year or so ago, I had a conversation online with another YA author in which she insisted that everyone was really feminist and that we should all just admit it. I said that I had long had trouble with the term feminist and wasn't sure what she meant by it. She said that feminist just meant that you believed men and women were equal. When I asked her what equal meant, she stopped responding. This seems to happen a lot to me because people imagine that equality is a simple term and that I'm being argumentative and asking for a definition, but I actually think that defining equality is difficult and perhaps impossible. Here are some ideas about what equality might mean. Equal pay for equal work, equal treatment under the law, equal treatment by the healthcare system, equal opportunity in education and in military combat, free access to birth control, alimony payments, and access to divorce for women, which are things that have happened over the turn of the 20th century, shared custody of children in a divorce settlement. You might think that all of these are obvious elements of equality. But here's my question. Does equality mean ignoring the physical differences in men and women, or is it trying to ameliorate them? Is it believing that men and women are essentially the same, or seeing them as essentially different and in need of different assistance? The reality is that there isn't just one kind of feminism. For the purposes of this talk, I'm going to talk about two kinds of feminism, with the understanding that obviously these are not the only two kinds of feminism, they're just the two most opposite kinds of feminism. The first I'm going to call American political white feminism, and the second I'm going to call French feminism, which may not be quite true to the French feminism that I learned in college, but I think it's a good shorthand. All right. American political white feminism is, as a male friend of mine described it, feminism that demands men and women are the same in every way that matters. It denies the body, and it denies traditional femininity as having value. Male virtues tend to be the ones that all aspire to. This means that women who are more masculine tend to get more power, and women who are more traditionally feminine are sometimes mocked or pitied. If you want to have more power, you should just act more masculine. Stop apologizing. Stop dressing in provocative clothing. Stop having children and stop changing your name when you marry. Stop staying home as a child giver. Get a job. Continue to climb the ladder of the corporate world until you reach the glass ceiling and then you can break it. Don't let men talk down to you. Call them out on sexism. Be aggressive. Point out when you're treated badly simply because you're a woman. Aha, but French feminism. Does feminism mean separate spheres or correlation? This is a particularly Mormon idea about what feminism means, because if you look back in the history of Mormon church, the Relief Society was originally an entirely separate sphere, or mostly separate. And when correlation happened, that was mostly when women became subordinate to men. Let me define French feminism here. French feminism is a feminism in which traditionally feminine qualities are applauded and valued. The female body and its cycles are spoken of openly, written about in artistic ways, drawn and sculpted. Femininity is applauded in male bodies as well as in female ones. There's no rule about who is allowed to be feminine and who isn't. Makeup, soft voices, childbearing, alluring clothing, feminine mystique, all are part of traditional femininity and are treated as worthy of investigation and equal treatment as male qualities like power and aggression. When I first heard about French feminism, I thought that it fit well within Mormonism and our ideas of a heavenly mother who embodied divinely feminine qualities, and Eve, who took the fruit because she understood the need for mortal life with its pain and she was willing to be the vessel of the human race. But French feminism and perhaps traditional Mormon feminism are not without problems. As many have pointed out before me, this feminism can simply reify the polarity between men and women. It can feel like a prison to women who do not fit into traditional feminine modes, and it makes it sound as though the body is everything. So let's go back to American political white feminism. When I was talking online about this speech last week, one of my friends said, in an attempt to embolden me, she said, "Crush patriarchy," as a parting comment. All I could think of was that it was a particularly patriarchal thing to say. Warlike metaphors and the goal of crushing a political structure are masculine ways to think and to interact in the world. If we as women and feminists are trying to crush patriarchy, aren't we just falling back into patriarchy and assuming that the only power to be had is masculine power? Is it possible for us to imagine a system outside of patriarchy? When our dream of success is thus so enmeshed in patriarchal views of the world. All right, so in conclusion, I just want to talk about some strains of Mormon feminism. Okay, so there's ordained women. Let Women Pray has been a movement. There are what I would call Heavenly Mother feminists, women who want to talk about Heavenly Mother more. They want to have more theological discussions about her. They want to be allowed to pray to her openly. I think there are Eve feminists, feminists within Mormonism who think of Eve and her choice and want to use her as the mother and as this icon of Mormon feminism. And I think there are a lot of other women who find power in different ways. I'm hoping that there is some way we can find it within ourselves to listen more to other women with their own diverse ways of being feminist, even if they don't call themselves feminists at all. I'm hoping that we can stop excommunicating each other for not being feminist enough and try instead to celebrate women around the world and around us who we find worthy of celebration in all their different wonders. In doing so, I hope to make feminism more inclusive and less about proving who is best in some weird phallic contest that makes no sense for women anyway. American white political feminism has been criticized much lately for its lack of intersectionality, the desire to include women of color and transgender women, for instance. And I'm also concerned about the ways in which I see patriarchy swallows up the demands of feminism and uses them against women themselves. So in the end, I find myself turning back to the German philosopher Theodor Adorno, whom I studied in graduate school in perhaps the most sexist institution that has ever existed, Princeton University. Princeton University, in case you don't know, did not become co-ed until 1972, which I think was the last of the Ivy Leagues. And when I went to Princeton, I imagined I was entering an elite liberal bastion of education where there would be no more sexism as I had experienced at BYU, and no more assumptions about what women could or couldn't do or should or shouldn't do. Instead, I found that there were no tenured female faculty members in the department. When asked why not, the professors told us with all sincerity that there simply weren't any women on the planet who were qualified to teach at Princeton. And so they said they were going to develop these women in-house. There were three assistant female profs while I was at Princeton. All three of them left after experiencing some terrible form of sexism from the other professors who continually told them that their work on women writers wasn't worthy of Princeton University. I was told that I could not do my dissertation on an obscure female writer unless I compared her to the greatest male German writer of all time, Goethe. Of the 20 greatest works of German literature we were tested on for our candidacy, none were written by women. And when I was in a class on German Romanticism by the dean of the graduate school and asked him why there were no women on the list, he said that we didn't have time for minor writers. At Princeton, I hated Theodor Adorno's insistence on critique. He refused to endorse any political party or any candidate. He refused to describe what a utopia would look like. He did this because he still felt that he was enmeshed in the old system, and anything he did to try to point to a new one would be tainted. I find myself in my older years feeling very much like Theodor Adorno as I try to describe a new feminism. I criticize more than I support any one system. Which one is right? They're all wrong. But they each have things to teach us about who we are and about what might come after this world is washed away if I may end with such a religious image. Thank you.
It's an honor to be here today with all of you. And I'm going to see if I can get this. So, okay, good. In April 1992's Salt Lake Tribune, Peggy Stack reported, 3 hours before the Relief Society's sesquicentennial exhibit was to open at the LDS Museum of Church History and Art, three quotes were removed because they were a little too sacred. Interestingly, these quotes were taken from or referred to the original Nauvoo Relief Society minutes. And the three quotes were, the society should move according to the ancient priesthood, and Joseph Smith wanted to make us a kingdom of priestesses, and the sisters will be queens of, and priestesses unto the Most High God. These three quotes were replaced by ones about the Relief Society's potential for service and blessings. This event I see as part of a much larger historical trend going back 150 years in which the Relief Society was limited, censored, or reinterpreted by male church leaders since the 1844 conflicts and the 1845 disbanding of the Relief Society and the 1855 writing of the history of the church. For example, a couple of examples. In the 1855 rewriting of the history of the church, which rewrote the Relief Society quotes, the revised quote says, "I now turn the key in your behalf." Whereas the actual quote said, "I now turn the key to you in the name of God, and this society shall rejoice, and knowledge and intelligence shall flow down from this time." Another revised quote was, "Delivering the keys of the priesthood to the church," where the actual quote from the minutes was, "Delivering the keys to this society and to the church. The keys of the kingdom are about to be given to them that they may be able to detect everything false as well as to the elders." Even as recently as 1992, a conference talk statement said that the prophet Joseph Smith had declared that the Relief Society was to receive instruction and direction from the priesthood leaders who presided over their activities. Yet in the minutes, the actual quote says, "The sisters shall elect a presiding officer to preside over them. And he, Joseph, would ordain them to preside over the society and let them preside just as the presidency preside over the church." Meanwhile, back at the 1992 Relief Society exhibit, its creator and curator, Marjorie Condor, told me, "You know, in 1991, I tried to access the Relief Society minute book at the church library, but it was inaccessible by every route I tried. It was easier to use the photocopy of a typescript I actually had in my hand than to get permission to see the original. And if not for that photocopy, it would have been impossible to create the exhibit." And then afterwards, the exhibit came under severe fire, which rocked me to the core, and for years afterward. However, by 2007, I was able to use the actual Relief Society minute book on a display for another exhibit that was built around 33 quotes from the minute book entitled "Something Extraordinary." And it really was extraordinary. The wheel had turned in that time. Let me find my other, I just have one other picture. Where is it? Okay, I'm just gonna. So it had gone from, these are copies of the minutes that I also have a copy. Like Marjorie, I and other feminists had this photocopy of a typescript that we carried around and kept privately and used for research and teaching. And then here's the real minutes that she was able to use in 2007. This illustrates a shifting boundary in access to the original Nauvoo Relief Society minutes and in treatment of the Relief Society itself, from disempowerment to empowerment and from church censorship to church publication of the entire text of the original Nauvoo minutes in 2009 online, and excerpts from the minutes in the Relief Society handbook, Daughters in My Kingdom, in 2011, and the full text with commentary and other texts in a book of Relief Society documents published this year in 2016. And one of the editors, Kate Holbrook, is here today. Was here. But until the minutes found their way online in 2009 and in books in 2011 and 2016, Marge and I and others had to use this TypeScript version. So the arrival of the original document online and in church texts was a colossal shift. And this is just one example of many, many shifts. Shifting boundaries related to women's theology and feminist theology. And so I want to look at the Relief Society, or I prefer to see the Relief Society minutes in the context, a larger context, of Mormon feminist theology, which includes recovering and theologizing the feminine in our religion, feminist readings and critiques of Mormon theology, and analyzing how gender is constructed by theology. I wrote in the book Latter-day Descent in 2011, "Feminist theologians examine how religion is gendered. Feminist theology excavates how gender is embedded in religious ideas and texts and how it is constructed, and how religion shapes gender and gender shapes religion." In reality, Mormon women have been doing have explored and been doing feminist theology in one way or another or in some form from the church beginnings in the 1820s, 30s, and 40s through the 19th and 20th century to the present time. And the list of women is endless, beginning with Lucy Mack Smith, Emma Hill, Eliza Snow, Sarah Granger Kimball, Emmeline Wells, the women's exponents, Susie Young Gates, and Leah Widsoe, and all of the women who were doing feminism in the 1920s, 30s, and 40s, the feminist dialogue in the 1960s, women historians in the church, writers at Exponent 2, feminists at BYU and RICS like myself in the 1970s, Mormons for ERA, the Algie Ballo Forum, Sunstone, MHA, Journal of Mormon History, feminist articles, books, and groups, the Mormon Women's Forum, BYU Voice in the 1980s, more feminist articles, books, and groups, and email forums in the 1990s, and the explosion of feminist writings and scholarship in articles, books, essays, blogs, podcasts, and groups like Feminist Mormon Housewives and so many others since 2000. I want to mention a couple of pivotal shifts in boundaries related to feminist theology during this vast time period when Mormon women have basically been doing feminist theology in one way or another. Those who see themselves as feminists and those who don't see themselves as feminists have all been engaging Mormon feminist theology. In 1990, it was a pivotal time. A New Relief Society presidency of Elaine Jack, Aline Clyde, and Chieko Okazaki were called. These women engaged women's ecclesiastical empowerment and authority in new ways. Also, they were preparing for the Relief Society sesquicentennial, the 150th anniversary in 1992, and new discoveries of the Relief Society history and minutes. Also, at that time, I saw a real need to name feminist theology because Mormon women had been doing feminist theology for 170 years, but not naming it or formalizing it. So in 1990, I called for us to own the words feminism and feminist theology in name and practice publicly. I called for formalizing feminist theology in the Mormon Women's Forum Quarterly and in a paper at Sunstone titled Toward a Mormon Feminist Theology. I was on a panel called The Current State of Mormon Theology at Sunstone. And afterwards, Peter Appleby from the U of U's philosophy department announced, "It's clear that feminist theology is the new horizon in Mormon theology." Soon after, our 1992 anthology, Women and Authority, reclaimed feminism and feminist theology in word and practice as truly Mormon, inherent in our own tradition, and we reclaimed the word priesthood as related to women. These were scary moves at that time, because very few feminists were willing to use the word feminism in public or in print before 1992. So the book itself moved the boundary, and afterwards I watched as men and women began using the terms freely in their writings and speeches in public. Unfortunately, the church's boundary at that time differed from mine. So in 1990 to 93, some church warnings and boundaries about feminism arose in conference talks and statements. Local leaders warned me not to talk about feminism in public. It was okay to do feminist work, but not in public. And since I was compiling a book on Mormon feminist theology, I knew that I would be crossing that boundary. So I continued. And published the book, much to their disappointment and surprise, in December of 1992. This, according to one general authority, gave them heartburn. So in May 1993, I met with a general authority about their concerns about my book. And he warned me that feminism was imposing secular ideas on the church, thus it would never be accepted by the brethren. I explained that we were not importing or imparting secular feminism, but we were recovering Mormon feminism within our own tradition. Secular feminism simply helped us see our own better. He gave me a clear boundary, but I felt I had to cross it. And it was a spiritual decision, a matter of conviction. I knew the cost, but I felt it was necessary because I felt that the boundary was based on misinformation and misunderstanding and fear, not on the truth. He and I failed to find common ground that day in our meeting, and half the blame was mine because, frankly, we both were too defensive. Neither one of us was listening to each other enough or taking each other seriously enough. This was the same week that Elder Packer warned that in his famous talk to the All Church Coordinating Council that three dangers facing the church were feminism, scholarship, and gays. And this was because they signified the secular. So the real concern and boundary was about protection from secularism and secular intrusions into sacred space and structures. Yet we weren't imposing the secular, we were excavating the sacred and ourselves. And the secular wasn't bad, it was, the secular gave us tools to help us see and name and understand the sacred better, far better than we ever had before. This included new theological moves, seeing what we hadn't seen or known before within our own tradition. And frankly, inspiration and truth are found in secular ideas and work and tools. And the sacred uses the secular, and the secular uses the sacred in reality. Soon after that, of course, several of us were excommunicated in September of 1993. Much has been written and said about that, but in reality, I see it as very simple. It was a fear, a boundary about the secular intruding on the sacred. Fortunately, we've come a long way in the intervening years. Between 1999 and 2001, I see another pivotal time when a great deal of progress was made and boundaries shifted. And this disjuncture in 1993 began to heal during that time period, from my perspective, between 1999 and 2001, when the church embraced secular and scholarly work as valuable and began sponsoring Mormon studies and scholarly conferences. Including feminist topics. Also, the Joseph Smith Papers Project began at that time. Since 2000, I've seen major progress with the church engaging women's history, feminist history, scholarship, and theology. Why? Why did this shift? I think several reasons. Maturation of scholarly and feminist work inside the church over time. Also, I think the explosions in the 1990s helped to relieve a lot of pressure and fear and helped us to actually face these things a little better. Non-Mormon and scholarly interest in work in Mormon studies compelled the church to see the value of outside scholarly work and create more access to scholarly documents. And also, it's just changing times and culture. Feminism is a given for women in and outside of the church. It's the norm. Also, the big issue, or the big influence, Mormon blogs, the internet, and the explosion of feminism on the internet, and the freely available information on the internet has helped to shift the boundary. In 2007, Bruce Hafen, in his article in the Ensign entitled Crossing Thresholds and Becoming Equal Partners, said, "For too long in the church, the men have been the theologians while the women have been the Christians. To be equal partners, each should be both a theologian and a Christian." I took note of that and saw it as a major boundary shift. Also, the Relief Society minutes becoming published online as part of the Joseph Smith Papers was the return of not only our women's canon, but our Mormon feminist theological canon in 2009, freely available to anyone on the internet. The Joseph Smith Papers themselves represent a huge shift in boundaries, where the church has made what was inaccessible openly and freely accessible now. Documents we could not get to 10, 20 years ago are now available. Also, in 2009 to 2012, President Julie B. Beck gave a series of talks in her authority as president of the Relief Society, talking about women's access to priesthood, both in power and authority, using words like ministry and priesthood applied to women, and describing the Relief Society as parallel with male priesthood quorums. I took note of this because she was crossing boundaries that 20 years earlier we had gotten in trouble for. So in 2012, I came back to the church. I felt compelled to cross that boundary of excommunication, alienation, and outsider status. Although it felt like a great gulf at the time, I felt compelled to do it. Why? Because I felt spiritually directed by a higher wisdom to cross that boundary and close that gap, not only for myself, but on behalf of others. Also, I saw the value and power of the LDS lay ministry compared to other ministerial forms that I had studied and practiced. Also, I saw clear signs that boundaries on feminist theology had shifted. For example, with President Beck and the Relief Society minutes and the other examples I've cited. Boundaries truly have shifted greatly in the last 20 years, though to many younger feminists and scholars, it doesn't feel that way. In the 1990s, we couldn't talk about feminist theology in public or women's relationship to priesthood without censure or threat of discipline. Today, we can do feminist theology in name and in public. We can argue about it, arm wrestle, publish it, and even church leaders themselves are talking about it, and even women's relationship to priesthood. Members are advancing feminist theology further in an explosion of articles, books, blogs, and groups like Ordained Women and Actions on Temple Square. Unfortunately, again, in 2014, we saw the return of church discipline, the assertion of another boundary relating to feminist theology. The church restated a very clear boundary in the First Presidency Statement of June 28, 2014, and in other related statements. This boundary set at that time by these statements said, only men are ordained to priesthood offices, and members are free to ask questions, but not to act in clear, open, deliberate public opposition to the church or its leaders, or persist in teaching false doctrine. And only men can attend general conference priesthood meeting. The group Ordained Women bravely tested these boundaries. And as a result, Kate Kelly's excommunication in 2014 and the discipline of other OW members was an enacting of these boundaries on the members. Personally, at this time, this juncture, I didn't feel a need to cross those boundaries myself. However, I cared very much about the women who did, and I found ways to support them personally. The most recent boundary that has been asserted that we've all noticed is the 2015 policy on gay couples and their families, saying that they are viewed as apostate and can't receive ordinances. This new boundary has been a subject of great discussion and concern and suffering. On this boundary, I have felt compelled to cross it and to minister openly and publicly to gay members and their families as part of the body of Christ, as I also embrace and minister to members of Ordained Women. However, along with these very hard boundaries that feel like hard lines that pull us back, there have been some continuing positive shifts forward that simultaneously coexist with each other. Elder Oaks in 2014 said, we haven't been accustomed to talking about women having the authority of the priesthood in their church callings. When set apart as a full-time missionary, a woman is given priesthood authority to perform a priesthood function. And when set apart as an officer or teacher in the church, she exercises priesthood authority in performing her assigned duties. This again signified a huge shift in feminist theology, paralleling almost verbatim what we had said in 1992. So in closing, what have we learned, or what have I learned through some of this boundary shifting over the last 25 years? I've learned that church boundaries do shift and change, as do our personal boundaries as well. Progress is a good thing, but it's not simply about pushing boundaries further, but unfolding higher wisdom and inclusion. We have simultaneous boundaries of progress and contraction, both at the same time. It's not just one or the other. So if we see only the contractions or only the progress, we're not seeing the whole picture. For some, these boundaries signify a need to make an extreme either-or choice, to be all in or all out, to conform or reject, stay or leave, one or the other. While for others, these boundaries signify an invitation to practice engagement on a case-by-case basis as a spiritual discipline to discern which boundary I'm going to honor and which boundary I'm going to violate or cross. Tension or dissonance between personal boundaries and group boundaries is a normal thing in every group we belong to, every organization. It's an inescapable reality. Our individual paths, identities, and ethics may overlap with the group or may depart extremely. And we all have to live with that and work with that and give each other permission to do that. A boundary is a signifier of a choice, yet it's not a true choice unless we have real freedom to consider both options, the agency to choose either one and decide for ourselves, because sometimes the right choice is to cross a boundary and violate it, and other times the right choice is to honor it. I think the most crucial issue is not whether we cross a boundary or honor it, but whether that decision is truly our own. And also whether we can give each other the space to navigate these boundaries and narratives ourselves. We are all continually drawing and changing boundaries in our decisions, personal ethics, and identities. As I wrote in 1992, it's not about a power struggle, but about finding identity. We shift and choose what we believe in many moments of personal revelation, choices, continually identifying what we will reject and retain of our own upbringing, culture, and theology. The challenge is to keep these as personal decisions rather than surrender our voice to another. So today, and looking forward to the future, I still see this as the most crucial issue facing members of the church and those in Mormon tradition and culture, our personal agency to discern our own ethical boundaries and distinguish truth from error within our history, our theology, our doctrine, our worship, our culture, our practice, and our policies. Our need to engage boundaries or cross them, to honor them or respect them, to change our position without punishment from each other. We have this need to decide for ourselves in order to refine and improve our religion and ourselves. Thanks.
My question is for Neylan. You talked in your presentation about sort of a bucolic or idyllic sisterhood, and I was just wondering how you see trans women, Orthodox Mormon trans women, fitting into the sisterhood.
I really don't have any experience with trans women. It's not something that
I feel personally comfortable talking about from experience, because anything that I know about trans women is from what I've read and been told by other women. Also, I think the issues around sexuality are something that I just haven't studied as closely as I have the community of sisterhood. I feel like it's a massive topic that really deserves a lot of study and a lot of consideration, and it's not something that I've particularly considered my forte. It certainly creates another factor by which we need to actively choose to embrace and be embraced. So I think, you know, in some ways we can hopefully compassionately engage it as a characteristic of a woman in our sisterhood that is as if she has another characteristic that, you know, in previous times may have caused her to be cast out of the community, and hopefully today we can look at it as something that we embrace. But I'm sorry that I don't have a more educated answer on that. It's not something that I've studied to respectfully answer.
You didn't ask me, Kate, but in the book Women in Authority, in my chapter on sister missionaries, I cite a case where a man who had served a mission discovered after he got home that he actually had both reproductive organs, and actually the female reproductive organs within him were more functional. So he went through a sex change operation and became female, and the church decided to honor all of his priesthood work before, but going forward she would not be exercising priesthood functions. Interesting case.
For Maxine, the garden story tells us that Eve crossed a boundary. I'm not sure that she had all of the knowledge about the consequences of what she was to do, maybe, but it seems that it's been many thousands of years since that story that she was recognized, at least by our church, as having done a courageous thing, as you have. Do you have any sense about that story?
Oh gosh, Eve. Before I answer that, I wanted to add one more point about the previous comment. There are many cases of trans, back to Kate's question, there are many cases, many, many, many transgendered and intersex members of the church, and we have not talked about that enough. There are many, like hundreds of cases, and many intersex members who I think deserve a great deal of attention, compassion, and who powerfully, through the body, deconstruct our ideas about gender. Anyway, back to Eve. I would just agree with you that the Mormon theological interpretation of Eve is extremely empowering and feminist in terms of seeing her as an empowered figure who leads out and Adam follows her. And interestingly, I guess it's okay to say this, in the Salt Lake Temple Celestial Room, there's a sculpture of a woman above the veil, so that when you pass into the celestial room, you see a sculpture of an angelic or kind of a celestial female white sculpture. Some have speculated that it's Mary, modeled on the Mary. Some have speculated it's the woman in Revelation. I think it's Eve redeemed, who awaits members to enter the celestial kingdom and greets them.
Can I ask a question? Is that okay, since no one else is asking? Mette, I think you already saw my question on Twitter. You liked it. So we were tweeting. Is it possible for there to be a woman who is not a feminist? I think is the question as I framed it. Because you were toying with this beautiful idea as a real feminist, right? I love the idea, but I'm wondering, with how expansive you went with your definitions, if you could ever rule a woman out. And that's not even going with men, because I.
Well, I mean, I think part of my point is that I certainly would. It doesn't seem like that would be my place. It seems like a patriarchal sort of thing to do in the first place is to exclude women. However, if a woman tells me she is not a feminist, I also wouldn't like say to her, "Oh yes, you are." I mean, I think that would be equally rude. I mean, I might be like ask her, "Do you feel like you have been excluded from feminism? Do you like why is that? Do you see womanhood differently than how feminists see it?" I mean, I think it would open up an interesting discussion. I have four sisters. Two have left the church and see things very differently. Two are still in the church and see, you know, traditional. I don't think either of them would consider themselves feminists, and I wouldn't put that label on them. So at some point, maybe a sisterhood is a more useful term within Mormonism to talk about it. Sometimes the term feminist is only useful in certain circles, so.
I've met lots of women who don't like to be labeled as feminists. And I think for them, because their definition is of something that is antagonistic towards men that they love, right? It's a power grab. And they see it as a zero-sum game where, you know, if they have more power, it's taking away from somebody that they love. And they're uncomfortable with that. So I think... You know, I think it's too simple for us to say, of course, you know, we're all feminists because we live in the modern age and we believe that, you know, modern America, and we believe that that men and women are equal, whatever that means. Because I feel like I've certainly encountered a lot of fear that institutions and sort of a balance of power that they've established within their own sphere would be disrupted.
A conversation I recently had in my Singles Ward Release Society was about education, and we were discussing it, and a lot of the responses were, I'm getting an education just in case something happens to my husband, or some along those lines. And I left feeling super discouraged, just because as a college student and like gaining my own education, it just seemed kind of a wasteful thing for me to be doing then. And so I just wonder how I can have those conversations with girls in my women in my ward or at school about how I can have my own career that I want and be a good mom someday as well.
I'm holding the microphone, so this causes my blood to boil. So Utah has the lowest rate of women in secondary and post-secondary education of any state in the United States, number 50. We have the same number of women matriculate into college, and yet we have the lowest number of graduating women in the country. It's such a horribly endemic cultural problem that you know, we create these institutions so that
our members, presumably both male and female, can establish marketable pre-professional skills so that they can then support their family. But we only expect half of that group to actually go out and act on those skills. And I went to a liberal arts college, so nobody understands what I studied in school at all, because I can't make any money with my degree. But it's such a hypocritical notion to say we're going to create a school for you where you can go and attain a pre-professional skill, you know, under the guise of being able to support your family, but then we expect you not to graduate, or we're going to set up a cultural expectation for you not to graduate. That said, it's also so incredibly short-sighted to consider a 21st century woman's life to be so narrow in its eras, and so narrow in its abilities, and so narrow in its technological reach to the outside world, that external interests are simply in the case of emergency. I mean, it's mind-boggling to me that paradigm still is being passed around. So,
so my first response to that is that I was lucky to grow up in a family where. My father, I think, tried to be a kind of feminist. There were certain chores that were for the guys only. One of them was automotive repair. But I do remember that when I told my dad I'd rather mow the lawn than stay inside and cook with my mom in the summer, he was like, go right for it. And he was very supportive and proud of my intention to get a PhD. In fact, I'm the only one of his children that ended up getting a PhD, and he has a PhD. I remember he called me on the phone when I finished the defense, and he said, "Congratulations, Dr. Ivie." And I had to tell him, like, "Dad, you know, I'm Dr. Harrison. I've been married for like 4 years." But he had clearly rehearsed this speech in his head, imagining, I think, that he would be saying it to one of his sons, but he ended up saying it to me. But that said, after I had my PhD, and I was quite young, so maybe that was part of it, but I remember in those early years when my kids were small, feeling very self-conscious about having a PhD, and maybe I didn't quite lie about it, but I certainly never brought it up in conversation with other women in the church, because I felt like whenever I did, it made me, nobody would talk to me anymore. It just happened. they thought that I was no longer part of the community, and so I would just. I remember when I taught at BYU, I was looking for childcare for my kids. I would tell people, "I have classes at BYU," and everybody, of course, assumed that I was a student, but I was in fact teaching at BYU, and I needed childcare while I was teaching. But those are the sorts of things that I really hope that your generation can stop doing. We can only do it by being vocal, and I hate to put the onus on you, but you're going to have to just say to people, "Oh, that's not why I get a degree. I have my own ambitions, and I feel like God has inspired me, or this is just who I am, and I'm not going to be somebody else." Find an authentic way. Please don't make another generation of women feel like they have to be embarrassed about wanting an education, being educated, or having a career.
It's important to remember that the rhetoric, the image, rarely matches the reality. So in Mormon culture, for example, in 1992, when I was researching for the book, I discovered the normative Utahn was a Mormon woman who worked outside of the home and had some education. And yet we were barely starting to get the message in the late 80s, early 90s, that it was okay to go to college and have a career outside the home. Yet the normative Utahn was a Mormon working mom with some education. And I haven't checked it recently. I need to check it again and see what the normative is. It still the same? Thank you, Ryan. So,
we have some of the lowest paying jobs.
Right. We have the lowest paying jobs, and yet
they're more likely to be part-time.
Okay. But I wonder how long that's been true, because I didn't research it. Do you know, Ryan, for like prior to 1990? 1990 was such a watershed time. But it's amazing to me that that's been the norm all this time. The other thing is birth control. When I was researching birth control in 1999 for an article, the norm was that in spite of different church policies changing over time until finally it was okay, women and men had been using birth control all the whole time. There was this huge gap between what maybe badly in some cases, but maybe not successfully in some cases. But in spite of the church, the official rhetoric, you know, changing from, you know, all the way from turn of the 20th century to it was inappropriate to prevent pregnancy at all, to 100 years later in 1999, the church policy handbook said that members should not counsel each other in this matter. It's entirely a personal decision how many children to have and whether to use birth control. And then you had all kinds of statements in between, but all during that time, members were using birth control. So the image and the rhetoric doesn't match the reality.
So looks like it's about time we should conclude, but I just want to thank Ryan and I. Oh, one more. Caroline, yes, please.
Sorry, it was kind of a comment about the discussion, but for me, I grew up in California, and I grew up in a very Mormon household, and I feel like the rhetoric that I was given in church and at home was that education was super important because that was the only thing you took with you in the afterlife. So I wonder, being in Utah for 2 years, I've experienced and I've seen some of the same kind of ideas from women and girls in college. So my question kind of goes to Ryan is, how much of that do you think is this socially enforced and informal, like social norms of like staying within these boundaries of this is how you be a good Utah Mormon woman versus how much of it is actual church ideas? Makes sense?
Yeah. I mean, that was actually, I wasn't going to say anything, but my initial response was this is still quasi doctrinal that women's primary responsibility is to be a mother. I mean, if you look at the Proclamation on the Family, it's right there. That's what it says. And so for that to trickle down and be a cultural norm that's reinforced, particularly here in Utah County, where 80% plus of the people are Mormon, it's not at all surprising. So to going back to your issue, right, like that you're finding this, it's because the church is teaching it, right? Now, is it everywhere, and are there people who dissent? Absolutely, that's true. There are people who dissent, but it's still kind of the quasi-official doctrine, right? And if that's the case... Brigham Young's dead. I mean, I'm just saying, I totally agree with you. I'm on your side, right? But what is the official position right now? The official position is woman's primary responsibility is to be a mother, right?
And not to educate children. I don't know that the word educate is in the Family Proclamation. It's to nurture.
To nurture. Yeah.
That's education is not part of nurturing, in my view. Okay, fine.
But I still assert that there is lots of room for us to establish those boundaries that I was talking about. That is your choice, whether you establish for yourself that an adoption of that belief, or if you set up a boundary for yourself and you say, I'm going to ignore that. That is your choice. And until more of our women, you know, start setting up those personal boundaries for themselves, that's what's going to determine that change and... Because I don't feel that the rhetoric is as heavy-hitting as you say. It's never been that rigid and heavy-hitting in my life at all. But I've looked at it from a very different lens. I've looked at it from this perspective of, you know, you're saying you look at it from that perspective that I was talking about of the eternal perspective, or that was the spiritual personality that was emphasized in your home. That was totally the spiritual personality that was emphasized in my home, too. Motherhood was just not a part of my... sort of spiritual development in my home, so I don't see it as much.
Okay, thank you to everyone who attended and participated, and we want to especially thank Ryan and Neylan and Mette and Maxine for their talks today. Thank you very much.